ESPN 94.1 FM and AM 930 present The Drive.
Welcome into the Wednesday, March 15th edition, Your Drive. It's beginning right now on ESPN 94.1 and AM 930. Our text line this hour is 304-396-TALK, 304-396-8255. So where do we begin? Where do we follow up yesterday? If you weren't with us yesterday, I encourage you right now to put it in your download queue on our podcast. Get yesterday's show if you did not hear it yesterday. Or if you follow me on Twitter, you want to get all the specifics of what happened on that show, you need to go right now and download that. Because Christian Spears was with us yesterday. You know, he's enjoying his one-year anniversary as being Marshall's athletic director. And so we got into a lot of things, and we'll outline some of that for you. And just kind of, I want to get more of your reaction to it. Yesterday, we were getting it, and he was hitting it, and we were rapid fire at some points of that interview. So I want to now sit back and just go over a few of the things that we heard and what he said and how you feel about it. And to do so, the text line is 304-396-TALK, 304-396-8255. Get you updated on what's happening right now. Marshall baseball earlier today in the capital city and taking on Ohio State. Couldn't play yesterday. That game was canceled due to weather conditions. A lot better for baseball today. And unfortunately, the Herd got beat at Gomart Ballpark in Charleston. 5-1, Ohio State with the win. The good news is the Herd will get an opportunity to get another game back on the schedule, as now Marshall is going to be taking on the Cincinnati Bearcats. That is going to be next Tuesday. That is going to be at 5 p.m. at Marge Schott Field. So the Thundering Herd lose a game with Ohio State, but pick one up with Cincinnati. That should be a fun one. For those of you maybe like to follow the Herd in baseball, maybe that's a day off you can take. Head up to the Queen City, see what's happening with, well, I think the Thundering Herd's going to surprise some people. In the baseball side of things, I think they're playing well. They're not winning every single game. They're not rocking like softball is. Let's just go ahead and say it right now. But I think they're getting it together. I'm really impressed with what's been transpiring with this baseball team so far. So not the result you want today. Get another crack at it here soon, and Cincinnati's going to be on the schedule, and that's going to be fun. I really like the fact that the Herd's playing teams, playing Ohio State, playing Cincinnati. When you get this new ballpark finished, you get to see a lot of teams maybe come back into Huntington because the facilities are going to be a lot better. Yeah, we've talked about this before. We know. I think we don't have to say that anymore. We know. The excuse will be something else now if a team doesn't want to come to Huntington, because you've got the facility. You've got a quality facility that is being built right now. So that is a topic for another day. We're going to get into what happened yesterday with our interview with Marshall Athletic Director Christian Spears. I think the first thing we've got to talk about, no speculation in the offseason, none of this. It's out there. Dan D'Antoni going to come back. He's going to be the head coach. I even got him to reconfirm that. I had a couple people texting me yesterday during the show. I had somebody actually call me and they realized, sorry, I can't call you right now on your cell phone. I need to ask, did he just say that and can you confirm it? And yes, he did say that and we can confirm it. So now the cat is out of the bag. We know Dan D'Antoni is coming back. Christian Spears even said if he wants to come back, he's coming back. So Dan's coming back. So he's going to be your head coach. And then the big thing for basketball was the Herd going to be playing in a multiple team event. And that's going to force the Herd to compete against some P1s or quad ones, quad twos. So quad one and quad two teams get to play some higher caliber teams. You might win some of those. You might lose some of them. You might win them all. You might lose them all. But you get them on your schedule. And I think that is much, much needed for Marshall baseball, basketball, football, any sport. You got to play the best opponents you can. And for basketball, there were zero quadrant one games, four quadrant two games. The rest were quadrant three and quadrant four. So I think this is a step in the right direction as far as getting some quality teams on the schedule, and you get to go to a multi-team event. How about that? That's pretty cool. So now you get to go to an event in the Cayman Islands, see the herd play for a few days, get some good matchups maybe you won't see normally and you wouldn't see at the Henderson Center anyway. Nice vacation for a few people, right? I got to figure out how I'm going to be on that trip. I need to talk to my friend Christian Spears and see how I'm going to be on that trip. So that was probably the big one there. And, of course, yeah, the one thing that I noticed a few people were picking up on, and there are a lot of things we got to talk about here, but one of the things that I think a lot of people picked up on, and I agree with the guy. I'm going to stand with him on this. He didn't like the way that Marshall games were officiated. Thought that there was some questionable calls, not just maybe a bad game, but thought there were some questionable calls. Even said that felt like some of the breaks that were going other teams' way, maybe the league wanted some of the older members to advance in the tournament, not necessarily wanting the new kids to advance, the new schools. So he wasn't alluding to it. He basically came out and said it. You could tell after talking to him that he just didn't feel like the refs gave Marshall a fair shake, and maybe the league was against the herd in certain ways. I don't know. I agree with him on the refs issue. I thought officiating was terrible. I don't think it was maybe slanted toward one team or another. I think it was just bad across the board. But I do agree with him on the whole. Officiating is bad in this league. You're not gonna get any help from the officials. You're gonna have to go out there and actually win the game. So I get that. I share that opinion. And I just did a drive by checking out different social media spots, see what some of the herd faithful are talking about, and some of you didn't like Christian calling out the Sun Belt. Some of you didn't like Christian calling out the officials or making that known publicly. So some of you did pick up on that. I do agree with him, though. But, hey, maybe, just maybe, officiating wasn't spot on in Sun Belt play. But I can say that. Honestly, I can say that. I'm not employed by Marshall University. I'm not employed as a member of the athletic team. I'm not connected. I'm outside looking in. I am, well, I know people in the athletic department. I have relationships, but I am not the athletic director, Marshall University. So when he said that yesterday, some of you said, no, wait a minute, what are you doing? Now the refs are going to come after us even more. I don't know if that's the case. We'll see, though. Now we're going to chart that, aren't we? We're going to be charting that. So every time the officials give Marshall a bad call, are we going to call out the athletic director on that one? Maybe. I don't know. We'll see. But I do agree with him there. So those are the big three items, or at least early big items. Dan D'Antoni coming back as the head coach, Marshall basketball team. Going to try to bump the schedule up. Doing so with a multiple team event, going to the Cayman Islands, playing some higher level teams, try to boost the resume up a little bit. Even the value of playing those teams and losing will increase and help the overall net and Marshall's perception. I agree. Got to have some of those teams on your schedule. And of course, to get to play those teams, maybe you have to do events like this, because how many of those programs are actually going to come down to Huntington or come up to Huntington or come to Huntington? How many of those teams are coming into the Cam Henderson Center? And I'll float this out here. I should have asked him this. It might have to happen after the current coaches of both teams are no longer the coaches of both teams, but I'm going to catch heat for this. That's all right. I'm okay with this. Here it comes. Would eventually an olive branch be warranted to try to mend the relationship between Marshall and WVU and basketball, have a neutral court game prior to conference? I wouldn't do it in – I hated it when it was in the middle of conference play. I hated it. Could that happen? And to make that happen, of course, I think you're going to have the current basketball coach at West Virginia and the current basketball coach at Marshall University no longer on the sidelines to maybe make this happen. Would that help? Or am I taking it too far? Am I pushing it just a little bit now? Because, again, I'm the guy that said, look, if they don't want to play, why play? If that program doesn't want to play, don't push it. That's fine. Go out and do your own thing. And I'm good with that, and I'm still good with that. But it was a quality game to have on the schedule. So could we see that in the future, or has that ship sailed? And I'm just waving at it right now as it goes up and down the Ohio River. Here's our text line, 304-396-TALK, 304-396-8255. More coming up on this edition of The Drive, ESPN 94.1 and AM 930.
This is The Drive with Paul Swann on ESPN 94.1 FM and AM 930.
We're taking your text this hour at 304-396-TALK, 304-396-8255. I'm going to add, get them in now. Tomorrow, unbeknownst to management, I'm going to be putting my feet on the desk, kicking back, and I'm going to be listening to and streaming some of the games as well. The tournament is in full effect. Tomorrow, we've got all the games here on ESPN 94.1 and AM 930. Got more action coming up from Dayton tonight. It's going to be 16 seeds Fairleigh Dickinson versus Texas Southern at 6:30, and 11th seeds Nevada and Arizona State. That's going to be about 9:10, and you can listen to those games here on ESPN 94.1 and AM 930. Some bad news if you were following along the NIT and you were hoping that Southern Miss would make a run. That's over. UAB beat them 88-60. Am I reading that right? UAB beat the regular season champion of Sunbelt 88-60. Wow. Got some work to do. Got some work to do here. I did not watch that game. But I can tell you this, Southern Miss got bodied in that second half. UAB outscored them 47-22 in that second half, so UAB getting it done. I'm not going to entertain any arguments that Conference USA is not as good as the Sun Belt, because right now I can't back that up. But guess what? We've got a good one tonight. If you are still clinging on to some of the local teams, Morehead State's going to be facing Clemson in the first round tonight, 7 o'clock in Clemson. This will be the first appearance for the Eagles in the NIT. I did not believe that at first when I read that. I didn't think that was possible. I'm not saying that NIT is a bad place. All I'm saying is, I thought a program like Morehead State, maybe not having success certain years, but good enough to play, would have been in the NIT more. So that shocked me a little bit, not too much. And, of course, keeping an eye on high school scores, West Virginia 4A, not quad A, 4A. Huntington beat South Charleston 67-44. So the Highlanders will face Morgantown in the semis. That's going to be 11:15 tomorrow morning from the Charleston Coliseum. And while we're talking about high school sports, just for a minute, Kentucky boys Sweet 16, Ashland versus Owensboro tonight. That is going to be at 8:15. You can listen to that on our sister station, Cat Sports 93.3 and 1340. So Ashland versus Owensboro tonight, 8:30 tip, 8:15 airtime, once again on Cat Sports 93.3 and 1340. But we've got good games coming up tonight. 16 seeds and the 11 seeds going at it. Fairleigh Dickinson versus Texas Southern, Nevada versus Arizona State, and then everything gets underway tomorrow. And those games right here on ESPN 94.1. and AM 930. So we'll get your text in just a moment. 304-396-TALK. 304-396-8255. Some of the things I want to recap from yesterday when speaking with Marshall Athletic Director Christian Spears. Basketball, you've got your coach, Dan D'Antoni. You've got a bump in the schedule. Going to be participating in the Cayman Islands next season. Maybe the officials aren't going to be very friendly towards Marshall, and that's been acknowledged by the athletic department. There are some other interesting things that we need to talk about as far as... Now, Christian, he likes to plan big. He has a wish list. There are a lot of things on his wish list that he's shooting for. And it looks like we're going to see some expansion. I don't know what that's going to look like. It's not really sketched out yet. You got to figure it out. But with West Virginia and certain laws that have passed, you've got conceal and carry. So Marshall, and because of a certain capacity, Marshall's going to have to expand the concourse at Jones C. Edwards Stadium. And a lot of that's going to have to do with conceal and carry. Also, metal detectors are going to have to be put in, which has been a common sight for many years now. If you go to an NFL game, you go to a baseball game, just depends on where you go, but you have to, if you're going to bring something in, it's going to have to be in a clear carry. It's going to have to be a certain size. You can't bring a monster-sized bag. And I always thought, well, if you're going to search the bag anyway, why does it have to be clear? I know there's some issues there. There's security reasons. I get it. But you know, when I go to a Bengals game, for example, yeah, they've got to check me to make sure that I don't have anything that could be considered dangerous. And if you're bringing something in, so if... say you're a diabetic, you got to bring your tester in and a few other things, maybe a candy bar. I don't know what might be allowed, but you know, if stuff like that's allowed, or you know, just you bringing in a clutch purse, got to be clear, and they're gonna check you at the door before you even get to where you go through the turnstile. They're gonna check you, so they got to push that out a little bit, and so. Look for that here in the future at Marshall football games. Probably all Marshall events eventually, you would think. But especially football. And you know, the concourse needs redone anyway. Absolutely needs redone. Concourses need redone at both the football stadium and the Cam Henderson Center. Those need to be priorities eventually figured out. And I know we've talked about the bathroom situation. Bathrooms are important. Bathrooms are a major convenience when you have a big venue. So much so that it was a bullet point. It was a bullet point when Steve Ballmer, talking about the Clippers' new arena, highlighting how many toilets and urinals that you can encounter now at a LA Clippers game. 1,160, to be exact. Now, we're not going to see 1,160 toilets and urinals at the Cam Henderson Center or at Jones C. Edwards Stadium by any stretch of the imagination, but those are items that probably need to be looked at as well. Don't have a full game plan on that just yet, or if we do, it's just, you know, how you pay for all this. But you know, a lot of this concourse talk, you know, partially because of conceal and carry. Are they going to have to just push some fencing area back a little bit more? I've always hoped that if you're going to do it, just redo the concourse and make it nice. To the best of your ability, make it nice. Maybe get rid of the fencing. Maybe enclose it in a little bit more. You can have more. You can have two sides. You can have concession points of sale on both sides of the concourse. You can expand your offerings. Maybe you can look at ways to expand walkways, expand, of course, restroom facilities. Those would be important things to me in the future as well. If you're going to do this, just go ahead and get as much of this done as you possibly can. But so that was something that, yeah, I knew had to be done eventually. It's still a possibility of, you know, major expansion, minor expansion. So, you know, we'll definitely keep an eye on that one and try to get an update as that continues. And the thing that came out of that, I don't know how many Herd fans are going to like this, but Marshall fans will not be allowed to leave and return in the future. Now, this isn't me against you. For those of you that like to go to the game at halftime, go to your vehicles, and then come back in when you know. So now the pass out's probably going to be done. You're in or you're out. There's no coming back. In or out. And I understand, for some people, you went out to your vehicle, you got some extra beverages, had your tailgate, you had some extra food there. Maybe you used the bathrooms outside the stadium. I don't know what your particular reason might be, but you're in or you're out. I have, in a long time, never had the ability anywhere else to go, okay, I'm going to leave, and then I'm going to come back. But it's incumbent upon the university to make sure that if they've got you, they've got to improve the fan experience. They've got to improve everything. There's got to be more points of sale. There's got to be more and better concessions. There's got to be better facilities. There's got to be more room. There's got to be more of everything. So I think this is not a one-way street. This is a, okay, if you're going to not have that, and again, you know, because the new rules and legislation, let's just call it that, you have to have some restrictions here. So I don't know how Herd fans are going to take to that. I always thought that it was a shame sometimes to look out and see more people on the tailgate lot than in the stadium. But if they're keeping you in, you need to have a reason to be able to stay in. And of course, that means you got to expand everything. What about the discussion to add to the size of the band? When we discussed that with Christian yesterday about adding sports, and of course, when I met him, I'm joking with him because I've done that for a long time now. Hey, let's talk hockey. No, they got track and field instead for men, and that's great. That's a recruiting tool as well. You get to bring in new student athletes. Also, you get to probably retain or attract football athletes. Hey, football players want to run track too. Now you have a track program, you can do that. And Christian's reasonings were, yeah, that's going to improve the student-athlete experience. It's also going to give more opportunities. That's going to bring in a lot more, you know, actual students to the university. That's going to increase enrollment. that's huge. You want to increase enrollment, and you want to do that as well with the band. I agree with that, that if you can throw more resources at the band, and not just the band, marching band, but the pep band as well. What is the difference between pro and college? It's the pomp and circumstance and the pageantry of college. You go to an NFL game, you go to a college game. Rule sets might be slightly different. What are some of the things that are different? Well, it's the pomp and circumstance, of course. And so marching bands have a role to play in the atmosphere. I am not sure if I'm the outlier on this or if I'm in the majority, but if you have a really good college band, really good college band, I don't need a house DJ. I'm sorry. I don't need a house DJ. Not for college football. You can, maybe you do. I've seen it done right. I went to a Bengals game a few years ago, and it was done right there. And I thought, hey, the DJ is really doing a great job. He's getting the crowd going. That's a different beast, though. College, can you imagine if you had a band twice the size of what you've got currently, and it was a more active participant in the game, and it was blaring, fired up, loud, and pointed at the visiting team? Talk about home field advantage a little bit more. I mean, that's part of the reason why the band moved this year. It was to get the band closer to the opposing team within rules and regulations. You can't put, if you could, you would put the band right behind their bench. The opposing team's bench, you would put it right behind there. You can't do that. So you get the band as close as you possibly can to the other team. Make some noise. Distract them just a little bit. If you had double the size of the pep band, that would be fantastic. Wouldn't it? You know, it'd be a different atmosphere. And, you know, we were talking about that yesterday with Christian. You know, the players wanted to have a little bit more say in some of the music. And I get that. As he said, the radio edit, the clean version. So it should be. And for whatever reason, that seems to be a bone to pick sometimes between the fans. Because I don't know if this is age or if this is demographics or just personal taste. But nobody seems ever to be fully on board with whatever's being played musically at the arena. Some think it's too old. Some think it's too new. Some think it's terrible. Don't like this music style. I don't like Baby Shark. It hasn't been played in a while at the arena. That's because of me. I'm not joking. Every time I hear Cotton Eye Joe, I want to pull my ears out. Every time I hear Cotton Eye Joe, I just want to rip my eardrums out. So I'm sure the players have got some say as well. So yeah, there was a lot of things that we covered. And if you missed it yesterday, don't be shy. Go back and get the podcast. It's on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcast. From our text line before we hit the break. Game with the ears, always good with fans, players, like a big, loud, inspired crowd, doesn't matter. The king of WVU athletics will never give Coach Dan a hug after a great game. It's a game after all. Come on. Can't we be friends afterwards? No. 304-396-TALK, 304-396-8255. More coming up on this edition of The Drive, ESPN 94.1 and AM 930.
This is The Drive with Paul Swann on ESPN 94.1 FM and AM 930.
We continue on with today's edition of The Drive on ESPN 94.1 and AM 930. You can be a part of the program by texting 304-396-TALK, 304-396-8255. We're getting set for first four action coming up tonight at 6:30 as the NCAA tournament begins in earnest tomorrow. But we've got to add a couple more teams to the bracket, and tonight we'll see if either Fairleigh Dickinson or Texas Southern will come out of that 16-seed matchup or out of the 11th-seed matchup, Nevada versus Arizona State. We've got both those games here on ESPN 94.1 and AM 930. And then, of course, if you want to follow along in high school basketball action and you are a fan of the Ashland Tomcats, then that game coming up tonight at 8:15. Ashland's in the Sweet 16 taking on Owensboro, and 8:30 is going to be tip. That game going to be on our sister station, Cat Sports, 93.3 and 1340. And here's a great thing to know. You can get the app for both stations. You can search for ESPN 94.1 and AM 930 on your app store, or you can go find Cat Sports, 93.3 and 1340, and you can listen to either game. We are broadcasting live or on the app. Just go to your app store, get the app on your iPhone or your Android device, and you can discover a lot of cool things that we're starting to do with the app as well. We even put the podcast right there on the app. So if you open up the app, you can go to the menu bar, and you can download the podcast right there. So you don't even have to pull it down from Apple Podcasts or wherever you get your podcasts. If you maybe you don't know too much about that and you would like to be able to listen to the show on demand, grab the app. It'll be right there for you. So that's just another reason why you should get that app. We took a little longer than we usually do in the break, so I want to get us back on track, and I want to leave the rest of the time for you, so I'll keep that text line open. Don't forget, we've got basketball all day tomorrow and on Friday, so no show tomorrow, no show Friday. If you want to get it off your chest, do it now, 304-396-TALK, 304-396-8255. This is The Drive on ESPN 94.1 and AM 930.
This is The Drive with Paul Swann on ESPN 94.1 FM and AM 930.
It's our final segment of today's edition of The Drive on ESPN 94.1 and AM 930. As a reminder, no show tomorrow or Friday. Next couple of days, we're going to be preempted because of the NCAA tournament. I hope you find some time throughout the day to tune in. You can get away with it in the office. Sure beats trying to watch the video stream, right? Try to do your work and watch the video stream. No, we're going to have round robin coverage all day long tomorrow, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. So wherever the action is, that's where Westwood One will take us. And all you have to do is lock your radio in right here on ESPN 94.1 and AM 930. Or you can listen usually on our streaming app, and tomorrow's tournament games, no exception. So you can download the app and you can listen that way, and you should be covered however you want to listen to the tournament. And, of course, we definitely appreciate you tuning into the show for every day. Won't be here with you tomorrow, so if you want to find me on social media, if something happens, I'm going to be on Twitter, at Paul Swann. But for the next few days, I hope we can just kick back, relax, listen, and, you know, watch some games as well. We've got Kentucky coming up on our sister station on Friday, Cat Sports 93.3 and 1340. WVU is the 9 seed in the South Regional and facing off against 8th seed Maryland. I think that's where we begin with our coverage on Westwood One tomorrow. So that's where we'll get underway with all the coverage. And we'll have coverage as well of Sunbelt champion Louisiana, the 13 seed, taking on 4 seed Tennessee. That's Thursday as well. So, you know, a couple of games that we're all going to be listening to, keeping an eye on, will be that West Virginia game, that Louisiana game. And we're all rooting for Louisiana. The better Louisiana does, the more money comes to the Sun Belt. So pack away any grudges. Pack them away. We are all rooting for Louisiana. even if you don't like them. We're all rooting for Louisiana. Louisiana, with a win, will elevate the profile of the league a little bit. If Louisiana keeps winning, it will elevate the profile of the league. Also, you will have more money coming in to the Sun Belt as you will accrue more units. We are all rooting for Louisiana. So get that out of your mind right now. I know it's hard for some people. I don't like that school, though. I'm not going to root for them. Yeah, of course you're going to root for them. You root for Southern Miss in the NIT. You root for Louisiana and the NCAA tournament. You root for these teams. If I was in Conference USA right now, as Marshall was in Conference USA, and you know, I would be rooting for FAU. I rooted for Memphis in the NCAA tournament. I used to root for Western Kentucky until Marshall actually played in a league with Western Kentucky. But now I can go back to, I don't know, I'm on the fence there. Is it always, it's acceptable not to root for Western Kentucky, right? Yeah, I think that's the pass. We get one pass. I think that was it in Conference USA. That's the pass there. So let's hope that Louisiana does well tomorrow and that the Sun Belt gets another day in the tournament. That means a little bit more of a payout to the league. Wouldn't it be great, though? I would love to see Louisiana get its way into the Sweet 16. That would be fantastic. Absolutely. Bring a little bit more attention to the Sun Belt and start building that profile up a little bit more. And I'm hoping that the Sun Belt as a whole, as an organization, as a collective, I'm hoping that there are serious conversations about how Sun Belt teams improve the perception of the league. And a previous athletic director said, winning fixes everything, obviously. But how do you improve the perception of the league? And maybe it starts with not taking bids to pay-to-play tournaments. Maybe it starts with improving the out-of-conference schedule. Maybe it starts with taking a multiple-team event, going to the Cayman Islands if you're Marshall, playing against higher caliber teams. Maybe it starts that way. And you improve the resumes. And you improve the facilities. And you do all the little things that maybe will attract players of higher caliber. And you keep rinsing and repeating that. All right, that's going to do it for this edition. Thanks for tuning in. I appreciate it. Sort of a quiet day today compared to yesterday. I mean, yesterday was just bomb after bomb after bomb being dropped by the athletic director. And today, sort of like the recap, the post-game of that. Back with you on Monday if something happens more pressing than can wait. We'll be on Twitter, at Paul Swann. Also, you never know, no promises. But if we need to do that special emergency podcast, we will. But that's going to do it for this edition. Don't forget, NCAA basketball tonight, 6:30. Tournament begins in earnest tomorrow at noon, all right here on ESPN 94.1 and AM 930.
WRBC Huntington, W227BS Huntington, your flagship home of the Marshall Thundering Herd and The Drive with Paul Swann, ESPN 94.1 FM and AM 930.